Dear friends and members of the EAF, let's start with this last night debate, dinner debate we have in this year. We have, as you know, for the smart cities, tomorrow the breakfast debate with my colleague Lambert, which is today with us. And I also want to welcome James Ellis. I hope some colleagues will, you know, arrive sooner or later. And as you all know, we are dedicated this time of this dinner debate to cybersecurity, the EU Action Plan. And the cybersecurity, the EU Action Plan dossier, it was voted yesterday in ITRE, as probably you all know. So, I mean, I had not to explain probably much about that. But before I introduce the speakers, since I was the rapporteur, still am the rapporteur, for this dossier, I have to tell you that I'm really happy with the outcome. Starting with the Commission proposal, I mean, there was some work to do it, in my view, and I, you know, tried to do it in the draft report I present. And after that, it became the negotiation in Parliament. The final outcome, it was, you know, a big support from a big coalition among all main political groups in ITRE, so it was a real, you know, overwhelmingly yes to the final proposal from ITRE, which I think is very good because I think it's really good one. But let me just, for those that maybe you are not so extremely familiar with the final, you know, content, to mention a number of things which, in one way or another, it is it's different what the Commission proposal put it in place. To start with the single point of contact, as you know, in contrast to the Commission's proposal, where Member States were obliged to designate a competent authority responsible for monitoring the application of this directive. So the directive, of course, was mentioned. Denise, ITRE believes that it's crucial to avoid the duplication of institutional structure that will potentially lead to conflicts of competence and disruption of internal national communications. Consequently, we believe that what Member States should designate are a single point of contact, be it a competent authority or not, that will coordinate all the communication. That's the first point, which differs from the Commission. Second, computer emergency response teams, so the so-called CERTs. In this case, while the Commission proposal mandates the creation of a national CERT, in a way disregarding the different nature and composition of existing CERTs, most Member States have more than one CERT, as you know, which deal with different types of incidents, and their composition can be private, public, or both. We believe that the proposal should focus on guaranteeing the full operability at all times and adequate resources of those CERTs that provide the services to all the sectors that fall under the scope of the directive. And now, let's move to the scope. That was also quite, I would say, a big difference with the Commission proposal. On the scope, as you are all very much aware, I'm sure, because we had the possibility and the opportunity to debate this in advance, the scope of the Commission proposal was indeed quite overreaching. Besides including the critical infrastructure operators and all the public sector, it includes a non-exhaustive list of what was denominated internet enables. The final compromise achieved in ITRE delimited the scope to those market operators, be them private or public, which are vital for our well-being, that is, market operators in the fields, as you know, of energy, transport, banking, financial markets, and health. There is indeed an addition to my original proposal, that it is the inclusion of cloud services. But here I underline only when linked to these crucial services for society. So it's important to know that when we are talking about cloud services, which was something that in the context and in the process of negotiating, well, was necessary to include, it was reduced to critical infrastructure sectors, to start with. And second, it is true, someone you can comment, that it is not in any recital, for example, explaining that was related to that sector. But it is clear that it is in that context and related to that sector. That can be clarified later on. So it's also the Council to play a role in all this. I mean, don't forget about. So the idea was just that. So I must mention as well that the only amendment which can affect to the ICT sector, which was not related, was not included in the compromise amendments, and in my view was quite important, was an amendment which saying that in the first review of this, that should be soon, there was established a date, it was primarily and especially for include all the ICT sector in the critical infrastructure, which in my view was a disproportionate way of thinking on that, because ICT today is the entire world. So, I mean, you cannot include the entire world in this, critical infrastructure. You can go maybe step by step, but it can be included not from the ICT sector, but for sure not the entire ICT sector. That amendment didn't get the support to pass, so failed. And now let me just go to the speakers. We have three gorgeous speakers here from three different companies. Our first speaker will be finally Francisco Chris Goh. Yvonne Leroux has an unexpected problem at the end. The second speaker will be Gérald Romner, Chief Product Security Office at SAP. And the third speaker will be Jonathan Sager, Governmental Programs Executive at IBM. Well, as you know, we have normally the starters first, and then immediately after, the floor will be for the three of you. Thank you very much.